so that was about the pedigree analysis. Now let's look at the another method that is used in studying human genetics. Okay, one of the other question that comes to your mind is genetics is the component, or genetics is the basis for every character, including certain diseases. Isn't it useful to us to actually know what type of abnormalities that are happening related to genetic diseases? So we need a tool to diagnose those things. And one of those traditional diagnostic tools that helped in human genetics greatly is karyotyping. Okay, what is karyotyping? So karyotyping is a complete set of human metaphase chromosomes. Basically, we are preparing a picture of human chromosomes from a particular stage of cell division called metaphase. Okay? It will become clear, like, why do we take something from metaphase and what do this chromosome picture would help us, how does it help us? So let's look at the methodology used for this. So we can take any actively dividing cell. Most of the times we take blood sample and we use WBCs for this. And we add a chemical called colchicine. And the role of this chemical is to arrest the chromosomes at metaphase. And why at metaphase? Chromosomes undergo the maximum condensation in the metaphase stage, which is a part of cell division, that is mitosis. So here we can best see the chromosomes. Easy to visualize and easy to analyze. That's why we use metaphase chromosomes by using a colchicine, which actually arrests the cell division at metaphase. Then what do? We actually add a hypotonic solution, meaning either it has less sucrose and the salt levels in this solution, and you dip the cells in this solution. And because of the low concentrations outside, normally water is entering into the cells, and cells actually swell. And why do we need the swelling process? If they swell, basically the nuclear swelling also happens. Chromosomes can distribute from each other, making it easy for us to observe. Once it swells, we actually drop it at a certain angle on a slide where it cell opens up and distributing the chromosomes. This is called chromosome spreads. Okay, so basically what we did here, we actually took an actively dividing cell and added a compound called colchicine, which arrests the cells in the metaphase, because we want those chromosomes in their maximum condition, so easy to observe. And then we add a hypotonic solution with less salt or sugar solution here, which will send the water into the cell and cell actually swells. And this helps us in distributing the chromosomes. And when you drop this swollen cell on a slide, normally it opens up and releasing the chromosomes or spreading the chromosomes. Hence these are called chromosome spreads. Okay, what do we do next? So we can take these chromosome spreads and stain them, because chromosomes as it is don't have color. Even if you try to look at them on the microscope, we cannot see their features. So we have to perform certain types of staining, and the standard staining for this is called GIMSA staining. GIMSA stain actually provides a pattern of banding called G banding. Certain regions in the chromosomes get more stained than the others. So we can actually get the banding pattern for that, and which will facilitate in classifying and separating the chromosomes to get an image of it. Okay. Right. So once we actually do the staining, we observe this under the microscope and take a picture of it. So with that, we'll obtain a picture of the chromosomes. Most likely all the chromosomes in the cells. What do we do next? So we can take this picture, cut those individual chromosomes, and then try to organize them to form something called karyogram, which is sometimes also called as ideogram. So we have now image of different chromosomes, right? So let's organize them to get this complete set of the image of the chromosomes. What do we do? So humans normally have 23 sets of chromosomes, right? And 22 of them are autosomes. And there is one set that is sex chromosomes. Okay? Right. And there are different sizes of the chromosomes. If you put all these 46 chromosomes together, you can identify them from, okay, the large, basically separate them based on the size, large ones to the small ones in the descending order. And then what you do, okay, you can actually look at the position of the centromere. So based on the position of centromere, because sometimes the centromere may lie in the exact center, we call metacentric chromosome, or it may lie slightly towards one of the chromatid, or sometimes it is maybe close to the end. So metacentric, submetacentric, it is too close to the telomere, it is called telocentric. So based on the position of the centromere, you can actually organize this. What do you get? The end image is you have all those chromosomes organized into groups and we number them 1 to 22 for the autosomes and 6 chromosomes will be placed at the bottom. There are two possibilities here. If you are talking about females, there are 2 X chromosomes, and if you are talking about males, 1 X chromosome and Y chromosome. Okay. As we finish talking about the preparation of this karyogram, which is the process of karyotyping, let's look at where exactly we can use it. What are the applications of such a method in human genetics? The applications include, as you are able to identify whether it has XX chromosome or XY chromosome, you can actually identify this in the fetal sample. Take a fetal sample, and if you want to identify the gender of that, you can use this methodology to identify it, which can be even used in different stages of the development. Okay. How is it done? It is done either using what is called amniocentesis. Okay? So you are actually taking amniotic fluid around the baby, or you can actually take chorionic villi sample. By using either of these samples, as we talked about, WBCs are used, but you can use fetal samples to determine the gender. But is it only limited to the gender? As we organized all the chromosomes, we can even compare these chromosomes and identify if there are any extra chromosomes. We are actually looking at chromosomal abnormalities. Okay? And these chromosomal abnormalities can be variation in number, and which is normally referred to as aneuploidy. So here, in aneuploidy, I'll give you a few examples. If I look at chromosomes, you can identify the abnormalities. They could be in number or they could be in the structure. Okay, in number, as I mentioned, is called abnormalities or called aneuploidy. Okay, they can happen abnormality or increase in numbers or decrease in numbers in sex chromosomes. Okay, some cases we have, instead of XX, we have XXY, the extra chromosome, which is called Klinefelter syndrome. It can even happen with the somatic chromosomes. The very well known case is called trisomy, which happens to be at the position 21. 21 trisomy, which is Down syndrome. So like that you can identify abnormalities in chromosome number. And you can also extend this method to identify abnormalities in chromosome structure, such as sometimes maybe you notice that there is an extra addition of a piece of chromosome, or sometimes there is a deletion of a chromosome. There are more complicated ones such as inversions, translocations, certain rearrangements that can happen between the chromosomes. Okay, so in summary, you can basically identify these aberrations or abnormalities in the chromosomes which are connected to the disease. There are other diseases such as Karyotyping syndrome. There are certain cases of cancers that happen due to translocation. Okay, so this is the major applications of karyotyping. Okay, but nowadays, little extension to that, because as I mentioned, GIMSA staining is traditionally used for this. But we need a little bit of resolution. Sometimes we have issues with this kind of method in resolution, and you cannot identify certain specific patterns or certain specific features of the chromosomes, because it is more like a superficial method with not much resolution. So what you can do is, there are new methods called spectral karyotyping. What you do here? Spectral karyotyping, the concept is same, but instead of using GIMSA like traditional stains, we actually use fluorescent dyes to stain the chromosomes. Okay? And when you stain them with the fluorescent dyes, instead of actually manually taking a picture and doing this, you can take a digital image and try to perform this separation and analysis part using a computer. Okay, so you have improved resolution here and improved banding because your specific staining using fluorescent dyes. Okay, and this would give us, this would tell us more about more specific modifications or changes that happens in the chromosomes, such as those that actually lead to tumor formation. Okay, those that lead to mental retardation. So this is an extension of karyotyping method, where we improvise the staining methodology and also analysis part to get more applications. Okay, so this is about karyotyping and what are the limitations of such a method. As I alluded to some of those issues that we have in karyotyping, we are actually looking at, somebody, we talk about limitations here. Okay, we talked about the global changes in the chromosomes, okay, using the traditional method. So we can say that we can identify the chromosomal region that has this abnormality, but we cannot pinpoint what particular gene is involved in this. And another thing is, certain genetic diseases are caused due to mutations, like one nucleotide change in a chromosome, which cannot be seen using karyotypes. Okay? So we cannot identify those genetic diseases caused due to few mutations or fine mutations. Okay? So these are some of the limitations of karyotyping, and another issues that you can think about. Traditionally, when we were using light microscopes to take these pictures, resolution was not great. Okay, so we had very poor resolution, but of course, as I talked about new staining methods and karyotyping, spectral karyotyping method improvised and solved some of the issues. Okay, what else are the issues related to karyotyping? So we talked about the regions, chromosomal regions, the mutations and the resolution. Sometimes these are all done by humans. There are human errors that can be introduced, because starting from the preparation of the specimen, the sample, to the analysis part is done by humans. Partly, as I mentioned, this can solve this because you are using computers to do this kind of analysis. Okay? But otherwise, normally you are introducing error into something that can be very important, because you can utilize this information in genetic counseling. As I mentioned, to identify whether there are any genetic abnormalities in the fetus. So this information is very valuable and very important. important. So we need to reduce those human errors by more modernizing these methods. These are some of the limitations of karyotyping. That's about another very important tool used in human genetics.